It's very...
Made the most of it.
Very sketchy.
In a cool way.
Somebody died in this room. That's why I like it. Gretchen, are you here?
So you guys were together for basically 3 weeks?
3 weeks?
Four weeks?
No, five weeks.
24 days, so whatever that translates.
It was five, six weeks.
It feels like
weeks.
We were there in Pittsburgh together for 6 weeks.
Yeah, we were there a while.
Did you have rehearsal period, or did you have...
Yeah, we had loads. Well, yeah, we had a week and a half like pre-production, so we rehearsed and stuff. But
It wasn't intense rehearsals. Yeah. It was like we would get together with Alfonso, either just me and Olivia, and we just kind of read scenes and then talk about them. It was more like just conversations at first.
Yeah, or individually.
Yeah. Then we would get together and kind of run through scenes, and he would talk about the way he wanted to shoot certain scenes, because a lot of times it's very specific. The rehearsals weren't too extensive because we had already been auditioning together for so long.
Yeah, we'd had the material for like 6 months prior to shooting. Because we were auditioning for so long.
So what was that all about?
I don't know.
They weren't set on us. They were just like, oh, don't know if they're good enough.
Well, they cast you first.
Cast me first.
I don't know what that's about.
She was good enough.
And that whole time, so you had the script, and they just kept on saying, oh, can you come back for one more?
Kind of. Like, we chemistry read together. We were the first to chemistry read together, and then we chemistry read with the boys and girls.
Yeah, I think the next day after our really great first chemistry read, which we were like, oh, we've got the parts, like this is it. And then the next day they're like, come in and read with this other girl.
Oh my God, is Olivia like, not good enough? Like, she's not made the
cut? I'm like, what? Like, I thought it went really well. And then I went right
through.
How
was the other girl?
Fine.
Don't lie. Don't lie.
No, she was good. Obviously. I'm not going to say.
What's her address?
I'm not going to name names.
Drop right now. Drop the name.
What's her address?
What's her address? Yeah, it was.
Oh, was it? I know it was.
You know the legend of who was there.
I know all the Greg she was with, so.
Well, you saw them. You're in the room.
I know. Because she was cast when we did the last.
I don't have this problem.
Last screen test. You come in later. You should be happy, though, you didn't have to be there. Because you would have been in the same boat with us. It would have been Olivia and then, like, two Earls and then three Gregs.
So was the thing that they just were looking for the coolest guy they could find and.
Or the weirdest.
You were the natural choice, or?
Or the weirdest.
Yeah. Was Earl being chemistry read, or were you just kind of showing up on your own? Because you kind of got your own space in the.
Yeah, I only chemistry read with Thomas, and it was like the best feeling. I don't know if he read with other Greggs. Did you? I mean, Earls.
I did read with other Earls at the screen test, but. They just didn't. None of them worked out, and so that Earl was the last one to be cast, and I think Alfonso
was
like panicking because he didn't have an Earl yet. And then Arja came in. It was like that.
It's my pop up.
And I'm like, all right, he's the guy.
Got it.
So do you all feel like veterans actors going into this?
No.
Nope.
I mean, you have a longer resume than your compatriots, but does this feel like a breakout thing for you guys, or does it feel like
definitely? This feels like a whole turning point, like a whole, like a new plateau for me.
This feels like the thing, the movie and the role that I've been working hard to get up to, and thank God it happened, because still be making horror movies.
Nothing wrong with that.
Nothing wrong with that, but just the quality of them sometimes isn't great.
So how did you start out?
Me?
Yeah.
I did like an after-school workshop and then got an agent when I was 14, just a really shitty local agent, talent agent, and auditioned for them, and they didn't think I was good enough because probably I got a monologue off the internet about anorexia, and I was like, all I've had today is a glass of water. So I wasn't good enough to be on their acting side, so I went onto the commercials and modeling side, and then some really cringy commercials and like model tracksuits and school uniform, but there was this casting director that lived next door to them, their offices, and she always fought for me, and she auditioned me to be the daughter of Christopher Eccleston's character in this BBC miniseries called Blackout, and I got that when I was 18, and then it was just like whirlwind from then on.
So was acting like something you wanted to do from the time you were little?
For sure. When I was 15, I started to take it seriously, but the plan was always to go to drama school, but I didn't get in, so. But I'd still be there now. If I'd gotten into drama school, I'd still be there now, so.
What does that tell you?
It's lucky that I didn't.
Yeah. You're cooking your way up to being a spear carrier, I guess.
A what?
A spear carrier? Is that what? How the drama school evolution happened?
I don't know. I don't know how it happens. My friends are there now, and it just seems so stressful, and so competitive, and yeah, it's bad times.
And how did you end up over here?
I auditioned, I put myself on tape for Bates Motel, got that off the self-tape, and a week later was flown out and started shooting that, and then...
So are you with Angelina now, or are you...
No.
Are you...
Nomad.
I'm a nomad. I just go from job to job with my suitcase.
You say nomad.
But I'm hopefully moving to New York this year, so...
Because you like the idea of New York, or because there's...
Because I love New York, and because... It's halfway between LA and London, and I'm Manchester, and I'm never home, and I don't like LA. I've been here on and off for 3 years, and I've still not like found my niche, and I get just incredibly lonely and panicky here. So just New York.
So you guys are from New York, from LA, are you?
No.
So are you from LA now, or are you?
I live in LA now. I'm from Dallas originally.
Yeah, I live in LA now, and I'm from Jacksonville, Florida.
So how'd you end up going from Jacksonville to L.A.?
Well, I did a camp in Florida with Adrian Armonte, or a program. He doesn't like to call it a camp. A program in Florida. And I heard it on the radio, and my dad thought it was a scam, which they usually are, let's be honest. And after I did that, I got signed with Chrome Talent Agency, but it was like, okay, I'm signed. All right.
You weren't getting any work.
I didn't even get auditions.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was just they wanted a signature. And they got it. But it was nothing. And so then I came to the camp program that he has out here in LA, and I did it, and that's where I met my agency. And my mom and dad were like, okay, let's move. I was like, oh, no pressure at all. You just cash your life in and move. If I mess up, just move back. Be hobos.
Were you that passionate about it, or were they just kind of
willing? I was, because they seen I was hungry for it. Like, I love changing emotion and being able to, you know, play other characters, you know. It's fun. I don't know. It's an addiction. It's just like why people drink Coca-Cola every day. It's like, you don't know. It tastes good. Acting tastes delicious. You know?
Yeah. And how'd you get your addiction? Do you have the addiction?
I do now, yeah. Wrong?
Ooh.
I started drinking when I was like, I guess it started like in theater in school. I just really was excited, like so excited just to go to rehearsals and stuff. And that's kind of where I realized it was something that I'd really like to do, but I lived in Dallas and there's not, you know, acting doesn't even seem like a possibility there. And, so I started taking these acting classes, and they'd have seminars, different people would come down, so I sort of got some opportunities through that, and it was just like a sort of series of events where it seemed like just the next step was to go to LA and try auditioning for a while, and I had a friend who was living out there, and I don't know, there's not like one moment where I'm like, okay, this is what I'm going to do, but it's like I kept trying, and things kept kind of going my way, and I realized, okay, maybe this is what I'm supposed to be doing, and now it's like... Now I love it, and I can't imagine doing anything else. It's kind of the thing where if someone tells you you're good at it, then it makes you really want to do it more. And and so I've really just kind of been riding that same wave. I don't know.
So is Alf? So what kind of director is Alfonso?
Terrible.
Wow.
Kidding.
No,
he's incredible.
A papa.
He's great. I feel like a lot of people act like he's our poppy. Mm-hmm. But I feel like people talk about him like he's some newbie who like, oh, or like just kind of broke out of the gate and like got really successful with this movie. But he's someone, I mean, he's like operates with so much more experience than a lot of directors that I've worked with, because he's worked with like the best. I mean, I think when he was like my age, he was watching movies with Martin Scorsese on Saturday afternoons, just talking to him, and then did second unit for Iñárritu and Nora Ephron and all these people. And so he's like been... like ready to break out for a long time, and he's so confident in his directing. It's really just inspiring to be around, and he loves actors and just really made us feel safe.
Very nurturing, very, very, very nurturing.
Is it hard to do? I mean, this picture is very, the visuals in this picture are very strong. It's a lot of stylized imagery and stuff. Yeah. Challenging? Does that make it harder, or is it, are you able to stay in the space emotionally as easily?
Yeah, well, he was really, like, careful about not getting in our way, just because, you know, he was like, well, this is what I want to do with the camera, but if that's weird for you, then don't, like, say, you know, say something, so it's not, doesn't look forced.
I had no idea what he was doing visually until I watched the film for the first time and saw his camera work and Chung's camera work. It's just, it's incredible. It really is. He really uses the camera like a paintbrush and really captures Greg's neuroses in a beautiful way until further on in the film where Greg finally is able to listen and the camera work becomes much more still as Greg is learning to take more information in, and I was overwhelmed. I was really just bowled over. I've never been a part of something that visually looked so, so beautiful.
Did you feel it on set? Did you know what you were, when it was working? Do you have that sense of it, or I just kind of so. Get through each scene?
No, I think this one like felt different. I feel like every scene was really special in its own way. There was never like a throwaway scene, or everything was some great accomplishment after finishing every scene. It felt like, okay, we got a real moment there. We're like, that's just gonna look really awesome. But I don't know. Like, his approach to each scene is so different depending on what it needed or what we needed to do. I mean, there's scenes with it just like the camera sitting still and we're, he just lets us use the space however we want. He would let us come and block the scene sometimes and then figure out how to shoot it after, which is kind of a slow way to work sometimes because...
Never felt slow, though.
Well, a couple times.
Oh, there was one when they were trying to work out how to do the scene where you come in and you say, do you want to go and get ice cream? Revolving...
I couldn't stop laughing every time you came
you
up to
the...
Oh, yeah, you perfectly timed burp.
Oh, yeah.
During the scene, and it was just, and then you just kept going, and it was amazing. I just really hoped when watching the film that they'd use that take. It was like, and you're going on, and it's always Hello Kitty, and he burped, and then just like, carried on with the line.
Yeah.
It was so good.
Yeah, but it was something, yeah, it was like doing a dance, sort of. Mm-hmm. And that was kind of fun, too. It didn't get in our way. It was just kind of fun to sort of play with it like that.
And are you Mr. Cool in real world?
As in Mr. Just like quiet, calm?
Well.
Yeah, that's me. I'm playing.
He's wearing a taco shirt.
Yeah, that explains everything, literally. I'm Earl.
I don't think Earl would wear a taco shirt, would he?
Earl would, but his taco shirt would be because he's, you know, just hungry. Mine is because I know it would be something that would stick out if you're walking down the sidewalk. You're going to notice a taco shirt. Then you're going to want to ask questions about that taco shirt. Then you're going to judge me for wearing the taco shirt. But you, like, inevitably like the taco shirt. Yeah.
It's an entire relationship with a taco shirt.
Yeah.
It's like a four-act play.
Yeah. I wouldn't cheat on her with a burger shirt or nothing like that. Wouldn't happen.
So how soon after the movie was done did you guys see the movie?
We finished it in July and it was December.
It was like right before Christmas that we watched it. Together.
Christmas present.
Yeah. It was early. Christmas came early.
Yeah.
You all got together to watch it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was us and Alfonso when we sat in the screening room and watched it, and I don't remember if I cried the first time
I didn't
watched
cry the
it.
First time. And
I was like too busy watching myself, like, why am I standing like that?
Or, my acne is migrating across my face in every single scene.
Yeah.
But then second time we were bawling. Second time you were still too nervous, weren't you?
I feel like I cry more like every time I see it now because I'm like,
the last two times
I realize
I've seen
what
it
is and what it means.
You've brought down.
So did you all? I mean, so how many times in were you by the time you got to Sundance?
Just one.
We'd only seen it once.
So that was just second time there.
Second time, but with the second time you're able to watch it, you're able to take in so much more because you are in your own head the first time you watch it. But something that you're in, you're just like looking at yourself like, why did I do that? And you're just completely just ripping apart your performance, and you come out just feeling really overwhelmed. And like, even though you can appreciate that it was amazing, you're just in your head about your own performance. Then the second time watching it, you see it in its entirety, and I was completely amazed by it. I was so proud. So proud.
And yeah, and you're watching with other people who have no idea about it, and they're laughing at things that like we didn't even think were that funny. Because the first time, I wonder if Alfonso thought like it didn't play well with us because we weren't laughing at certain parts or whatever. But
yeah,
but you laugh at each other.
Oh, I laugh all the time. Mm-hmm. I laugh at stuff that the audience doesn't even pick up on because I know these two so well. I'll just let some of their reactions and their facial expressions. I'll just start giggling up. Yeah.
So how intimidating? I assume you guys were at Eccles or.
Mm-hmm. Eccles,
I love seeing that massive theater.
Yeah.
It's the second time you've seen it, but this is the first time anybody else is going to see it. Scared to death, just kind of.
Nervous, but I was so excited. I was so excited.
I was just lucky. Feel like so lucky to be there.
So yeah, it was all our first Sundance, so that's it was really a prize cool. Just getting in.
Yeah.
Yeah, we felt that was it. That was it. That we'd done it.
I was like nervous. Everything that,
yeah. You were nervous.
I was nervous when I was on the plane. Oh. I was like, oh crap. I'm not ready. Jesus, take the wheel.
You're not ready to be seen, or you're not ready to be loved, or you're not ready to what?
No, I didn't know what to expect from Sundance, because I didn't know what Sundance was. And then going to it, and I'm like, oh, I pray that people like the movie. Sir, we need you to move along. Okay, do you like the movie? I mean, okay, you got it. You know, that was on my mind the whole time. Because it's like we poured so much into it, and I was just like, I pray that people get it. And they did.
So did you know you had them pretty early on in that screening?
They were very vocal, yeah.
Yeah, very vocal.
Like, it was really easy to tell that they were liking it, or at least a lot of people were.
I was sat next to Molly Shannon, and that was her first time watching it. And she, towards the end, just crumpled from the waist down and just started sobbing. And I had to, like, I didn't know what to tell. I was just, like, rubbing her leg, like, it's okay. It was mad. Oh, just,
she feels a lot.
She feels so much. Oh,
for everyone.
Yeah, and just all around, you could just hear different, vocal reactions and just bodily functions happening. It was good bodily functions.
A few flatulations, no. But we let that slide.
So the whirlwind starts, the bidding starts.
Yeah,
the movie becomes like the grand dam of the festival immediately.
Yeah, it was just like a really weird series of, like, everything was just like one unbelievable thing after another happening, and it was moving too fast to really comprehend.
Yeah.
Because I think we sold it that same night that it premiered at Eccles, and all the producers just like going away into a corner to like have little powwow meetings about, oh, like, which and where do we want to sell it?
Jeremy. Wow.
Oh, I didn't mean to do Jeremy's voice.
I thought you did Jeremy then.
I think I did subconsciously.
It was overwhelming. And then just the hoo-ha afterwards where suddenly everyone wants to interview us. Because we were given quite a bad summary in the Sundance booklet.
I think that was everyone was saying, like, oh, well, by judging by like the synopsis in the Sundance program, like it was not on our radar at all.
Yeah, like, it was like a coming of age movie about cancer.
And it's still like, even to this day, we struggle to find like a good way to describe it that doesn't make it sound lame.
Yeah.
Because it's really hard. The movie lives in all these details. It's really hard to just give you like a 20-second intro.
We had media training and they were like, just try and, it's concise. It's about three friends that overcome tragedy, and it's also funny. And we're like, we're not saying that. That sounds terrible. It sounds so bad.
Yeah.
It was really frustrating.
It sounded fake too.
Like, yeah.
So it's about three friends who overcome hardship.
And it's sometimes also really funny.
But it's like, no, we're not.
Sad. And it's like, no, like, you don't get it. Like, you don't get to tell me how to describe this experience that means so much to us, and it's so much more than what, like.
It's like, well, how would you describe it?
Your job is to give us a sound bite, but I'm just like,
no, it was so frustrating. Really, it's like, frustrating. Oh, well, you tell us. You tell us how you'd like to sell the movie. Go on. And
I was like, yeah, and she's like, okay. Don't get defensive. And I was like, well, I am going to get defensive. Yeah. This is my thing. This is my life.
But after the 20th time somebody asks you the same question, it must be.
I still try.
Be hoping for your bad little clip.
No. You still want to try because it's so hard because people have given it such a, like a, I think a, bad rep just by the name, like, oh, it's such a cute, this Sundance-y titled movie, blah, blah, blah.
You get really
boring.
You're really defensive when someone uses the word cute or quirky. Cute.
Yeah. That can start a fight.
Oh, it's so cute, but it's cute. We had a radio interview the other day in, I don't know where we were, I can't remember, but in one of the cities in America. And in one of the cities. And this girl was like, no, I loved it. It was so cute. It was so cute. It had, like, so many feels. It was just so cute. And I was like,
yeah, but you just had to speak up and be like, well, it's not cute. Like, it's not just cute. And, like, I guess there's some parts where you say, oh, it's very cute.
But I get, like, as a woman, when someone says, oh, you're so cute, like, that's like a, that's an insult a little bit. Like, what? I'm like a little furry. Like, animals are cute. Like, furry animals are cute. Babies are cute.
Yeah, and then she tried to go back. She's like, well, I don't mean cute like that. I was like, well, it doesn't matter how you mean cute. It's the content. It's, like, the idea that cute is. It doesn't convey at all, like, the way that we feel about
it. Yeah, it's hard. It is hard because we did really feel so much shooting it and poured so much of ourselves into it, and everyone put blood, sweat, and tears into it because they just really, really believed in Jesse and the script and Alfonso. And so, yeah, when someone just tries to brush it off by just saying giving it a really shitty...
It's like they're dismissing it almost.
Yeah, it does feel really dismissive and like I feel disrespected. Yeah.
But it's a weird phenomenon of something that you love so much, then having, you know, it becomes the world. It's no longer
right. It doesn't really your thing anymore. Yeah, yeah. It doesn't really.
And cute
matter.
Might be a high compliment for that girl woman. I don't
know. That's the thing. It's like
she might think.
I feel like she uses it a lot. You know, like, there's a Louis C.K. skit where he's like, where someone's eating like a chicken burger. It's like, oh my god, it's amazing. And like, no, it's not amazing. Like, it didn't fucking blow your mind. Like, amazing is like, oh my god, like my mouth is gonna fall off. This is just MSG heaven. And so I feel like people use.
People have like these their go-to adjectives, and I was like, you have to throw some other adjectives in there if you're going
to
talk
about
this
people
movie.
Use superlatives too much to describe things when it was just fine. It was just fine. Mm-hmm. It was nice, and so like maybe she uses cute a lot, and you know everything's cute. It's under the umbrella of cute.
Kind of went off on her though.
We did on the radio.
I did. Wow, you guys are bullies.
Oh yeah, you weren't there.
You weren't there.
I wasn't. Thank you. Thank you so much.
We needed
much.
You. We needed some like comic relief because we were just like, no, it is not cute. No.
Shut up.
Not cute.
That could be the tagline. Not cutest movie of the year.
Not cute.
Uncute film.
This is the part where you know that the movie is not cute.
Not just cute.
So it must be like this film feels like it's kind of part of a moment in a way that there is this complexity and emotion and. It's not, you know, films with teenagers and 20-somethings or whatever, not just kind of surface anymore.
Right, and it's not, like, you're not selling teenagers as, like, being so...
perfect.
Well, no, like, saying the most profound thing in the moment and the most perfect thing in the moment and being really sentimental, because they're not. My 15-year-old sister is not... Nothing is sentimental. It's awkward, and it's just you're trying to navigate how to...
Trying to be cool. She's trying to be cool.
She's trying to be so cool.
My sister's the same way. But, just like the characters, they react. Yeah, they don't see it as a beautiful, poignant time in their lives. Mm-hmm. It's awkward and uncomfortable. Yep. And they're selfish. I like the movie owns up to like the selfishness or stubbornness of teenagers, at least.
But also they're just people. Just humans, like, first and foremost.
They're good and bad. Yeah, they're not just their qualities.
Yeah. You think of yourself and then someone... you know, opens you up and allows you to be selfless, and you know, you open up to the people that are worth it, are worth you learning how to give and to connect and do things without having to receive. I feel like sometimes in a lot of movies, the boy or the girl is only doing it because they've got romantic interest in the one that they love, and they're trying to do all these things, they're trying to become this better person in order to have this big gratuitous kiss at the end, you know, of the movie.
Yeah, and it's the kind of thing that the audience can't take part in. Like, being in love is a two-person thing. But like, if it's just friendship, hopefully, like, the audience feels like they can be a part of that, or that they could be one of our friends, you know.
Or one of us, one of the characters see themselves really in.
Well, yeah, you want to participate, I think, as an audience, and you want to feel like you're following the story, and what would you do in that given moment, and then... One of the things that's nice about this movie is it almost never takes the turn you expect it to take.
No.
It keeps on twisting in some other way.
Yeah. It's not cliche.
Yeah. And I feel like a lot of these moments in the film, Jesse has written it in the way that has written, oh my God, God school.
Has written it.
Has in a way that, you know, you would react to these situations. You know, no one's the perfect person. No one's become this martyr because these things are happening to them.
That's right.
Thanks.
So it's just like Project X.
It's exactly. It's like a spiritual sequel in a way. I'm glad you saw that also.
So was that? And actually, we did an interview with Kirby Bliss Blanton for that movie.
Oh,
oddly
really?
Enough, I don't know how that happened.
Is that 10 times?
Kirby Bliss Blanton.
Candyman shows up at the end of that. So did you think that was your explosive moment in Hollywood?
Yeah, I did. I mean, because it was, you know, in a way. That was like, that opened so many doors for me. And, you know, you get to this place where you're like, okay, I've arrived. Now I can be really picky and say no to a bunch of stuff. And then I did that, and then it didn't work for a year. And then, like, I had to take a bunch of movies that I wasn't that excited about. And then me and Earl came along, thankfully. And, like, now it's like, okay, I'm doing the work that I want to be doing. And hopefully I can be recognized for this now. And thanks.
You're Thomas Mann from Me and Earl and the Dying Girl. Can I take a picture?
Are you getting a lot of that yet? Are people recognizing you all on the streets from this yet?
For this movie?
Yeah.
Not yet.
Are you getting it from other movies? Or are you getting it from the...
Well, there's always like a... Oh my God, I love doing Project X, man. Not since I've cut my hair. I don't get it.
Yeah, but I do get Project X still all the time.
I get it when I pop up at the screenings.
And say hello, I'm here.
I don't know why. But my mom took me to one screening at... and we sat in line. And then two dudes that follow the book and the film... and also follow like Thomas and Olivia. Like, oh, you're in the movie. I was like, yeah, I'm sorry. And then my job, a couple of the kids, I did a party like a couple weeks ago and they noticed me. Mm. So that was fun. I was like, wow, it's in the Jewish community.
Yeah, he DJs for like bar mitzvahs. Yeah. Huh. And bat mitzvahs?
Yeah, bar and bots.
You go both ways with it. Is that something that is attractive to you guys as young talent, rising talent? I mean, is the whole celebrity side of it of interest?
Nope. Mm-hmm.
We got followed in Canada. Was it
we
Canada?
Got a police chase in Toronto, yeah. Not a police chase, a paparazzi chase.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was exciting.
In Toronto.
But no.
No, I don't want that.
No, I mean, I really feel for people like, I don't know, like Kristen Stewart or someone who just can't go anywhere, you know, and without being bothered. Or people that... The weird thing is, like, people who think that they know you and think that you owe them something because you've opened up to them, you know, but not directly. But they feel like they know you and that they're like entitled to some time with you.
And sometimes people are a bit rude as well. Mm. They're having a really, really shitty day. It was like after, like, there was a screening in Chicago where I was really, really ill. So we did a Q&A and then Alfonso kind of excused me from, like, doing, like, the meet and greet afterwards because I needed to go home and just, like, take some drugs and fall asleep and try and have a good night's sleep. And then afterwards, like, coming out, they're like, Olivia, please, Olivia, just take a picture with us, please, I know you're ill, just please. And I'm like,
I know you're ill, I don't care.
They forgot she was a human being. Like,
I don't know, it's a weird thing because it just leaves a really, like, foul taste in your mouth because you don't want that. And just this weird, like, I don't know, desperate, hungry, like, just so they can have a picture and show the mates and put it on Instagram. Just be like, look who I saw, you know? And then as I was trying to come out and I was trying to, and there was all these people like putting pictures and selfies in front of you and you're just trying to get to your car because you're so ill and you just want to go to sleep. And I think human decency completely goes out the window.
Mm. So is it all about having enough success to get to the point where you can wait for the right thing?
Where you can have control over, you know, just doing projects that mean something and projects that are like highly coveted. I feel like, you know, a lot of people auditioned for Me and Earl and really wanted it. And it, anytime you like get one of those movies, it's like, okay, like you're good. Like you're in a place now where you have like some say and people are excited, you know, to meet with you and sit down with you. And
but it's always fluctuating. There's always a new flavor of the month.
Yeah. Yeah.
So take it with a pinch of salt. Mm-hmm.
But you guys want to do this for your lives. This is a...
I mean, this is till death to us part. We're only 21, so...
But for now, yeah. For now, it's all I want to do.
And yeah.
Just keep working with people that are, like, better than you, you know?
Yeah. Mm.
And will you be nervous on opening day next week? Will you be wondering what the numbers are going to be and all
that?
Well,
what city are we? I mean, Pittsburgh.
I don't know. I think other people worry about that.
Yeah, but. I don't want to know anything about it, actually. I really don't. It makes me really anxious. Because we've done the work and we've put, and you know, if people go and see, that's amazing. And if they don't, then whatever, they'll go and see Jurassic World.
The people, but, the people I wanted to see it, they see it, they're seeing it tonight, so I'm cool. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You already got your posse done.
I'm good.
How much money it makes doesn't interest me at all.
You've already taken your pleasure from having done this.
Yeah.
I think, yeah, and just going around doing these like Q&As and stuff and screenings and people coming up to you afterwards and saying how much it means to them.
Yeah.
And I don't know, like that's the most gratifying thing is like seeing people like have their own personal experiences watching the movie is all you can ask for, you know.
Excellent. Thank you guys very much.
Oh,
thank you.
Was that all right?
You guys were terrific.
Did we like go a bit defensive and like no?
I know we kind of like lost track of time.
It's not fucking cute.
It's gonna be everybody's favorite part.
Okay.
Oh, great.
Yeah.